Hi, my name is Nirav Karani and welcome to my presentation on test-time adaptable neural networks. We looked at the problem of medical image segmentation. So here we have MRI images of the brain and the prostate and some segmentations predicted by some neural networks. Now the dice or the intersection over union numbers of these neural networks are actually quite good. And they're even comparable with inter-expert accuracies. So we can even ask if the segmentation problem is solved. The answer is not quite, because the figures that we see here are for unseen test images from training domains. So the domains that were used to train these networks. And in this context, by domain, we mean things like the hospital, the scanner which was used to acquire the image, the imaging protocol, and so on. So what happens when we change the domain? It turns out that the performance drops quite a bit. So for example, here the dice numbers go from 85 to something like 60. And in this case, even to very small numbers when the protocol itself changes. But actually, even for relatively small changes in the images, we see quite remarkable dice drops. So the first take-home message is that CNNs are not robust against domain shifts. Now, this is actually a very well-known problem in the literature, and it has been looked at in a number of different machine learning settings. So here we list these settings and what these settings do in the source and the target domain in terms of their data requirement and in terms of the algorithm that is implemented. And the first four rows here are essentially supervised learning methods, but you know, here you do transfer learning, so you require not a lot of labeled examples in the target domain. Here you do unsupervised domain adaptation, so you require no labeled examples in the target domain. But you have to carry your source domain data set to each target domain. So really the most attractive of the supervised learning methods is domain generalization, where the learning happens in the source domain and then at the target domain, there's just prediction. However, it turns out that although you get some amount of robustness by having different regularization functions here, you still don't have as much robustness as you would like. So then what people do is unsupervised learning, where you don't have any training phase at all. But actually, for the test image, you do this maximum A post-TDRI optimization. And it turns out that this map estimation is very robust to the domain shifts that we talked about, because there is no training phase, so there is no overfitting to a particular source domain. So these are kind of the two complementary benefits of you have domain generalization, which can leverage large label data sets to learn complex input-output mappings. And you have unsupervised learning, which can be quite robust to different domain shifts. So then the question is, can we combine these two benefits? And this is what we propose here. So we say we do domain generalization. So we do all the tricks of domain generalization that were being done here. But then we also say, let's also adapt the parameters for each test image. So then we have domain generalization with test time adaptation. And in this figure, what we see is that these balls represent probability distributions. So if you have a point from the source domain and you pass it through a network that was trained on the source domain, then you get a segmentation label which belongs to this ball of good segmentations. Okay. But if you have a point from the target domain which does not overlap with the source domain, then this gets mapped to a point outside the ball of good segmentations. And we say that with domain generalization, you may be able to improve. You may be able to get this point closer to the ball of good segmentations, but it's difficult to guarantee good performance for totally unseen target domains. And therefore, it might be nice to have adaptability for each test image. And then the first question is which parameters to adapt. And here we say that we introduce a small network in front of the segmentation network. And these are the parameters that we adapt for each test image. And the second question is how to drive this adaptation. And for this, we say the segmentation that you predict, it's outside the ball of good segmentation. So let's try to drive it inside the ball of good segmentations. Now, and to quantify this ball of good segmentations, we use a denoising autoencoder. So we treat the predicted segmentation as a noisy segmentation, and we use the denoising autoencoder to, you know, denoise it. And then we say, for each test image, adapt these normalization parameters such that the input of the denoising autoencoder looks like the output of the denoising autoencoder. And this is our test time optimization loss. So what happens qualitatively is that if you have an image like this with a ground truth label like this, then if you try to predict the segmentation using a network that was trained on another domain, you will have some mistakes like this. Okay. And then you will pass this through a denoising autoencoder, which will try to correct these mistakes. And then you will try to adapt the normalization parameters to make this guy look like this guy. And then you will have improved segmentation with some mistakes reduced. And then you will again pass that through the denoising autoencoder. And you will keep doing this procedure. And you will see that over a number of iterations, the ground truth dice improves quite nicely. So, and just before finishing, I would like to show you a few other concurrent test time adaptation rules. So what we did was we had this kind of an implicit prior using a denoising autoencoder in the label space of segmentations. There's a recent ICLR paper which does it for image classification, and the prior that they have is that they want to minimize the entropy of the prediction. And then there were a couple of works last year which, instead of having a prior in the output space, they had a prior at some intermediate feature space using self-supervised networks. Okay, so the second take-home message is that if you want to improve your robustness to domain shifts, you should start thinking probably about adapting a CNNs for each test image. Okay, with that, let me thank my supervisor and my colleagues. And if you have any questions, please feel free to write to this email address. And let me end with this quote, which says, "You know, you may not always have control on the input, but maybe you can change your model to suit the input." Thank you.